plants are our most important partners in our quest for space exploration. How well we can grow plants in space will determine the fate of our interplanetary ambitions. We got to talk to one of the top experts in the field.
But the ultimate objective is growing plants on the moon to learn what not to do, because when you get to Mars, you can't really make mistakes.
This is Plants in Space. Hey, I'm Tasha, and you're watching Floralogic. Today, we're looking up at the stars to look for space plants. Nope, I'm not talking about a monster from a sci-fi flick, but rather our favorite space station carry-ons. Plants have always been an important part of humanity's dreams of space travel. In fact, we launched plant seeds into space 15 years before we mustered up the courage to climb into manned spacecraft ourselves. Even pre-crewed missions, we understood that the conditions of space were probably less than habitable for humans. So sending seeds enabled us to get a first glimpse into how microgravity and the ionizing radiation of space would impact biological life forms. The first case of sending plant matter into space was in 1946, when seeds were strapped to a scientific rocket in White Sands, New Mexico. These rockets, called V-2, were the first long-range guided ballistic missiles. They were developed by the Nazis and captured by the Americans during the Second World War. Between 1946 and 1952, many such rocket launches took place, carrying a variety of seeds beyond the Kármán line, which is widely accepted as the edge of space at about 100 kilometers above sea level. These first space-bound seeds included corn, rye, and cottonseed, as well as fungus spores. After these seeds were brought back to Earth, they were planted to see if they were still viable. Scientists learned that while germination can be delayed or rates reduced by exposure to space, most seeds were still good to grow. The most famous of these space seeds became what are known as the moon trees. As part of NASA's third trip to the lunar surface in 1971, astronaut and former U.S. Forest Service smoke jumper Stuart Roosa brought thousands of loblolly pine, sycamore, sweetgum, redwood, and Douglas fir seeds along for the ride. The U.S. Forest Service sent these seeds with him and kept some on Earth as a control group to see if there was any difference in germination and growth after their time in space. Many of the space seeds grew and were later planted in special ceremonies to commemorate the bicentennial of the establishment of the United States in 1976. You can still find moon trees and their half-moon tree descendants today all around the U.S. Even more than 50 years later, we're still sending seeds into space, and they're being run through the gauntlet on the International Space Station. In 2021, barley seeds provided by a popular whiskey brand were added to the Materials International Space Station Experiment platform, located outside the ISS. Here, the seeds are exposed to extremes as the ISS whips around the Earth once every 90-ish minutes. As the ISS orbits in and out of the Earth's shadow, the temperature fluctuates about 200 degrees Celsius. The results of these kinds of experiments help to inform us of what kind of plants might be viable crops in the harshest conditions of space. Once back on Earth, the barley seeds that were on the MIS platform germinated, seemingly completely unfazed by their insane journey. The space barley seeds that weren't grown for science were sent back to the distiller to make what I can only assume will one day be called space whiskey. And in a nod to the original moon trees, Artemis 1, an uncrewed mission that explored the moon in 2022, once again brought seeds from loblolly pine, American sycamore, sweetgum, Douglas fir, and giant sequoia trees for a new generation of moon trees on Earth. But spaceplant research isn't just about seeing if seeds will germinate on Earth after re-entry. Experiments also center around growing plants in the conditions of space, since the very future of habitation in space and on other planets utterly depends on it. We wanted to understand the logistics of space farming, so our producer, Andrés, asked one of the world's top experts in growing plants in controlled environments to tell us all about the challenges of extraterrestrial farming.
I'm Dr. Mike Dixon. I'm the director of the Controlled Environment Systems Research Facility and University Professor Emeritus at the University of Guelph.
I was reading some of your papers, and of course two of the main issues are air pressure and also the kind of like the formula of the gases that you put in that air. So could you tell me a little bit of how that affects the plants, and also do we try to imitate Earth air in those environments, or are there other formulas that work better in those type of situations?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. The scientific issue that we addressed back 25 years ago, how low can you take the pressure and still have plants performing their functions that we require of them? Food, oxygen, recycling fresh water, scrubbing CO2, and making us feel good. And if the answer had been, well, you need full Earth atmosphere, then with the kind of technology that we can consider today, human space exploration is done.
Building space farms with conditions identical to those of Earth is simply impossible right now. And even if it was possible, it would take so much energy to do that it would be more efficient to just deliver food in spaceships. So, can we do it without an Earth-like atmosphere?
Well, it turns out plants are pretty tough. We could take the pressure down to 1/10 of Earth's atmospheric pressure, so roughly 10 kilopascals total pressure, as long as 7 of them are oxygen, 1.2 water vapor, 0.1 CO2, and then a little bit of argon or nitrogen as a buffer gas. So that's the recipe. And if you start seeds under those conditions, they will perform as though they're growing in your backyard garden. So success, I mean, human space exploration can continue.
But that means that the weak link will be suspiciously great ape shaped.
So plants are not going to be the limitation. It's us. We're the weakness. We can't survive at 10 kilopascals and 7 kilopascals of oxygen. We need, 20 plus kPa of oxygen. Our respiration demands are much greater than plants. So plants aren't going to be the limitation. They will be our life support.
The other factor is gravity. Is there any effect on plants because of low gravity?
The only experience we had there is some of the experiments that our colleagues at NASA have deployed on the International Space Station. And they have a centrifuge there that allows them to replicate partial gravity, like 1/6 or 1/3, which is Mars and the Moon. In my opinion, and this is widely held, we don't need to consider microgravity, such as the International Space Station, because remember that mass and energy issue? We don't need to spend those mass and energy resources in low Earth orbit, because we can just resupply the International Space Station indefinitely, as we do. It's when we get on the surface of Mars that it becomes much, much more required and almost critical in the long term. So we have to figure out what not to do on the moon, which was currently the plan. I don't know where it's going now, but figure out what the challenges are in a 1/6 gravity well. But at least there's an up and a down. And so water will go around in a reasonably predictable way. We can do the arithmetic and figure that all out, but we have to get it done before we have long-term exploration missions on Mars with many explorers that require life support.
The food grown on Mars would have to be small plants that grow in high densities. Tomatoes, peppers, cucumbers, leafy greens, high-calorie staples like potatoes, and protein-rich plants like soybeans and duckweed. Farm animals would be too energetically expensive to grow, so meat is off the menu. Medicinal plants are another key component of space farming.
We're working with a molecular biology group working with tobacco, a specific strain of tobacco that produces the breast cancer drug Herceptin with a process that they've patented. Red sage is another crop we're looking at. Medicinal mushrooms, there's a wide range of them. And we're working on a particular strain called reishi, which has medicinal applications. And then nutraceuticals like mint and cilantro are other crops that we're looking at, which have, broad range tech transfer to commercial opportunities.
Looking even further than that, there are greater challenges if we ever venture beyond Mars. First of all, taking supplies for missions that could be years long is not sustainable. Food will have to be grown in space to keep those on board fed in the long run. Secondly, in the almost perfect vacuum of space, there's nothing but a few protons per square meter, and certainly no breathable air. humans figured out long ago that we need to BYO oxygen when leaving Earth. We've already come up with ways to create oxygen in space. On the ISS, they use a process called electrolysis, in which electricity is run through water and splits the bonded hydrogen and oxygen atoms. But plants not only make oxygen, they also absorb the pesky carbon dioxide we exhale. Thirdly, plants are good for our well-being. We know from our lives on Earth that being near plants is good for our mental health. In Japan, it's called shinrin-yoku, or forest bathing, which is the therapeutic act of simply being among the trees. Doctors in Japan will recommend shinrin-yoku to patients who are removed from nature in urban settings for their well-being. What could be more removed from nature than being hundreds of thousands or even millions of kilometers from Earth? According to NASA, fresh flowers and gardens in space give astronauts a beautiful environment and lets them stay connected to nature on Earth. They also promote overall psychological well-being for crew members. But growing plants in microgravity would be a challenge. We know that being in microgravity too long has a serious impact on the human body, causing everything from bone loss to muscle atrophy to changes in balance, the immune system, and even eyesight. We also know from Earth that it's almost impossible to study deep sea fish on the surface because the difference in pressure changes them so dramatically, sometimes even killing them. It's why the internet famous blobfish looks like a pile of goo on the surface. So how would plants fare in space in the absence of gravity? How would they grow without the orientation gravity gives to their roots and shoots? NASA had its first harvest in 2015 with a batch of red lettuce. The space lettuce proved to be more bitter than red lettuce on Earth, which is likely due to increased levels of sesquiterpene lactones, naturally protective chemicals that occur in these types of lettuces when they're grown under stress. The purpose of these protective chemicals is to combat potential bacteria or fungi, discourage neighboring plants from stealing resources, or make curious animals, or even astronauts, want to avoid eating them. Apparently, the astronauts didn't mind because everything tastes blander in space. The fluids in the body pool more evenly all over, causing slight nasal congestion and making it like trying to taste food when you have a head cold. That's why astronauts gravitate towards stronger flavors. Soon after the first lettuce came space's first flowers, Zinnias, in 2016, which were immortalized by Commander Scott Kelly with his photo and caption, "Yes, there are other life forms in space." Much like the zinnias he grew, Kelly himself was a space experiment. Just like the moon tree seeds, after a year aboard the ISS, Scott Kelly was compared to his control subject, his twin brother Mark, who had remained on Earth to test for physiological, molecular, and cognitive changes. After his retirement, Kelly was given some dried zinnia seeds from the flowers he grew in space to plant in his own garden. Since then, we've successfully grown an Earth's bounty of crops in space. From cucumbers, cabbage, wheat, mustard, rice, and romaine lettuce, to sunflowers and tulips. Currently on the ISS, there's a greenhouse called the Vegetable Production System, or Veggie for short, that serves the dual purpose of scientific study and giving the astronauts aboard some much-appreciated fresh produce.
When you're eating rehydrated, freeze-dried meals out of a bag for months, a nice green and crunchy cucumber must taste like the heavens. These gardens aren't the ones of sci-fi that take up an entire area of the ship. Veggie is only about the size of a carry-on suitcase. Each plant is grown in a sort of pillow, chock full of clay-like soil and fertilizer. Plants are grown this way because in zero gravity, roots spread in weird directions, loose soil floats away, and water beads, which kills the plant from drought. If you've ever seen a video of how liquid turns itself into glistening spheres in space, you'll get the need for creating a basis for plants that keeps soil together and roots hydrated. Without gravity to guide their upward growth, LED lights that mimic the sun tell these space plants which direction to grow.
Actually, let's see what liquids look like in space again. Amazing. The other garden on the ISS is called the Advanced Plant Habitat and is automated and controlled from Earth. Sensors and cameras constantly monitor the growth of the plants, and water is automatically given. The only care they need from the astronauts is harvesting when they're ready. One of the goals of the Advanced Plant Habitat is to understand how microgravity affects lignin, the plant equivalent of bones, and if plants that are genetically modified to have less lignin could potentially be more nutritious and easier to compost in space. Having a constant supply of nutritious food is going to be essential for long-distance space travel. A one-way trip to Mars currently would take about 9 months. NASA sends food supplies to the ISS on average every 45 days, which means we'd have to have good crops to be able to make it to Mars and back. And that's not even accounting for the time spent on the barren red planet. Okay, so through all of these experiments, we know that although it's more challenging to grow plants in orbit, it is entirely possible. But what about on the moon? An experiment in 2022 set out to understand if plants could be grown in soil taken from the moon. Samples from the Apollo 11, 12, and 17 were used to grow mustard family member Thale cress. All the samples did grow, but were not as robust and showed genetic signs of stress. This research is also aiming to help us understand how we can modify plants to grow in less than ideal conditions on Earth. But it's not just in lunar soil. Plants have also now been grown on the moon itself. In January 2019, China's Chang'e 4 lunar lander touched down on the far side with a miniature growth chamber stocked with cotton, rapeseed, potatoes, and Arabidopsis seeds on board. The purpose of this experiment was to lay the foundation for future habitation on the moon. In space research, almost everything has applications on Earth. The learning from these missions can help us grow crops in food deserts and polar regions. They could also help us grow medicinal plants all over the world. So, what else would Mike like to see grown on our only natural satellite? Remember the space barley we mentioned earlier? Yep, that was Mike.
I was part of the international committee called the Candidate Crop Selection Committee. And as the Canadian delegate, at the very first meeting I attended at Kennedy Space Center, I proposed barley and roses. Roses, I rationalized, were the psychological benefit. Imagine the favors you could get with that first dozen roses from the moon. Nevertheless, roses were rejected because, once again, that mass and energy. You can't afford the mass and energy cost of growing a plant that you're not going to eat. It's driven by food. So, okay, roses were out. I accepted that. But then I put barley on the table. And I made the mistake of supporting my submission with the proclamation that humans always make alcohol.
Sadly, this was an argument that, in the low-gravity environment of the moon, didn't hold much weight. That is, until Ray Wheeler, a crop scientist at NASA and a kindred spirit, joined the team.
So Ray and I, over dinner at his place one night, we colluded, and barley is now officially on the human space exploration candidate crop list.
A huge win for people who like beer and whiskey, and a great day for Canada, and therefore the world. Thanks, Mike, for taking the time to chat with us. For the future of space plants, I am simply over the moon. The sky's the limit in what they can achieve. My advice about growing plants in space? Keep reaching for the stars. Until then, I'm thanking my lucky stars that we're surrounded by plants down here on Earth. So, what should we talk about next? Let me know in the comments below and be sure to subscribe for new videos every week. Bye.